Norm Finkelstein and Rabbi Shmuley. I've been waiting for this debate. I heard about it a couple days ago. I was waiting for the video to drop. Now, you know, Rabbi Shmuley likes to brag and he likes to rant a lot and he also likes to lie. Rabbi Shmuley actually made a statement before the debate actually was released on Piers Morgan's show. Here he is bragging, claiming that he destroyed Norm Finkelstein. You'll be able to see for yourself and tell me what you think. But let's get into this.
Hi, everybody. I just completed my debate on Piers Morgan Uncensored against America's foremost Jewish anti-Semite, Professor Norm Finkelstein. Professor, I use the word loosely. He's not tenured anywhere. I promise you I would digitally decapitate, digitally disembowel, and digitally destroy him, and God willing, you'll decide whether I kept my promise or not. Why do I speak that way? And people say we shouldn't speak that way. It's to draw a line between our opponents and us. We don't decapitate people. We don't shoot them in the vaginas. We don't cut their breasts off. We don't behead their children. We Jews are moral. Even Israel's worst.
Make sure you hold on to that part that he said right there about where people were shot, and he's still spreading the beheaded babies lie, by the way. Pay attention to that. That'll be important during the debate.
Enemies has not accused even a single Israeli soldier, as they falsely accuse us of genocide, of rape, for example, because they know that's impossible on the part of an Israeli soldier. What we do is defend ourselves in the public sphere. We do stop the libel once and for all. We stop the defamation. We digitally decapitate people on news programs. We digitally disembowel people in op-ed opinion editorials. We digitally destroy our enemies on Instagram, social media. We are moral people, but we will never be defamed again. Watch the show. You'll decide for yourselves whether I kept my pledge with God's blessing to my people and to all the supporters of Israel to shut down this rabid anti-Semite, Norman Finkelstein, who actually wrote hours into the October 7th attack that every fiber of his being was gladdened by the attacks on the children, on the women. He actually wrote this and said, glory, glory, hallelujah. The Palestinians shot Jewish women in the vagina. Glory, hallelujah. They cut off babies as glory, hallelujah. What a pig.
This guy is a con artist. That's exactly who Rabbi Shmuley is. And if you pay attention to the way that he talks and how he continues to lie, you can see that very well. Now, Piers Morgan actually said this. I was surprised to see this from Piers. He said this in response to Rabbi Shmuley. You were very personally insulting to Norm Finkelstein, but he wasn't to you, despite extreme provocation. I thought you overdid the ad hominem attacks. So that's coming from Piers Morgan, who actually moderated the debate. Now, let's go ahead and get into the debate. Hold on to your horses for this one, folks.
There are many ways to read it. You can read it politically, you can read it militarily, you can read it strategically, or you can read it from a point of view of human rights and international law, so long as it bears on human rights. Now, when it comes to the very last consideration, I think it's very clear how we should read it, namely the International Court of Justice, the supreme judicial body in the world, has said that Israel is under two obligations. Obligation number one is to honor the laws of war in what it's doing in Gaza. And obligation number two, Israel has to provide humanitarian aid and assistance to the people of Gaza. Those are its two obligations under international law. The court also ruled that Israel is plausibly committing genocide, and there is no evidence whatsoever, zero evidence, that since the court ruling, Israel has changed its tactics or its strategy in Gaza. So as of now, as we speak, Israel is still, by the conclusion of 15 judges in the International Court of Justice, 15 of the 17 judges, Israel is committing genocide or plausibly committing genocide, and it's not honoring its obligations as they were spelled out by the International Court of Justice.
Okay. Rabbi Shmuley, you tweeted this morning when we booked you for this debate. You called Norman Finkelstein an anti-Semite. You said, you have my word that God willing, I will digitally decapitate, digitally disembowel, and digitally destroy him. Do you think that was the right kind of rhetoric before you try and debate such a...
But that's him revealing just how nasty and evil he is. That's what this is. Someone was asking me in the chat, is he really a rabbi? I think so, but he was also a reality TV star. I don't know if everyone knows that. Like, this guy also used to be close friends with Michael Jackson. He's an opportunist. He's a freaking con man.
You know, serious matter?
First of all, thank you for having me back, Pierce. It's nice to see you. And Norm, I hope you don't mind if I call you Norm. You can please call me Shmuley. Norman Finkelstein is on the show for only one reason. If the journalistic idiom that Jews are news is true, because, you know, Israel's this big, it gets this much attention, then how much more so, Jewish anti-Semites get the brightest headlights. Norman Finkelstein is the foremost Jewish anti-Semite on planet Earth. He actually attacked his own parents, whose only crime was to be Jewish. Their entire family was annihilated in Warsaw. They're not victims. They hated Germans and wanted them dead. He didn't think to himself, maybe my parents wanted the Germans to suffer to stop the war, to break the will of the German people, to stop murdering, gassing 10,000 Jews per day. His hatred of the Jewish people has extended even to his own family. He calls Israel a satanic state that comes from the boils of hell. He calls it a vandal state. He said that the 15 people murdered in the Charlie Hebdo massacres, he has no sympathy for them whatsoever. But this is the most telling thing of all, and you discussed this the last time. He said, on October 7th, hours after the massacre of 1,200 Jews started, he wrote, "It warms every fiber of my soul to see the children of Gaza smiling as their arrogant Jewish supremacists that have been humbled. The stars above in heaven are looking down. Glory, glory, hallelujah." Let's just go through this. 400 women shot in the genitals, their breasts cut off as terrorists played with their bloody breasts like a football.
Pause. Okay. Remember I told you with the Twitter clip that he had where he mentioned like people shot in the genitals, like that kind of thing. Remember I said, pay attention to that when we get to the debate. So you see what he's doing, right? You see what he's doing. So first of all, we have no evidence of that. He's trying to sound as sick and disgusting as possible to get people to have more sympathy for the state of Israel. This is also a part of the Zionist playbook, to exaggerate, to lie, to zoom in on certain body parts that we would find to be, you know, offensive or whatever, right? Okay, now that's the first time he says this during this debate.
Glory, hallelujah! Women shot in their genitals, Norm. Glory! You should be a televangelist. Glory, hallelujah! Children burned to death and beheaded. Glory, hallelujah. Come on.
Notice how he's still repeating the beheaded babies lie. So I don't know how many times I have to hear someone repeat that lie on Pierce Morgan's show when it has been debunked on his show multiple times. So Rabbi Shmuley, this guy's a liar. And it's not just him. Again, a lot of the Zionists, they're doing this. They're doing it on social media too. They're still repeating that lie when it's been actually debunked.
Come on. You're a fear person, Pierce. This is exactly what your friend Douglas Murray said, because he refuses to debate Norman Finkelstein. He called him a sociopath. He said Norman Finkelstein is a psychotic. He's not on your show because he's a serious academic. Wolfgang Benz, professor of Ellingen, who is one of the foremost German historians of the Holocaust, said the only thing interesting about Norman Finkelstein is that he needs a psychiatrist.
Okay, well, look.
Professor Wolfgang. Professor Wolfgang.
I want to just ask you this, though. It's interesting. Norman Finkelstein gave a pretty measured argument and response to my first question. You've gone ad hominem immediately and attacked the man, not the issue, and not the question that I asked you, which is to respond to what he was saying, which is a growing feeling around the world, by the way, that Israel is now committing, as he put it, as the court said, a plausible genocide. I don't happen to think it is genocide they're doing, but what I do think is happening is that there is a shameful number of innocent women and children being slaughtered on a daily basis, and I don't see what the end game is other than the obliteration of most of Gaza and many people living there. So
So, you know, it's gotten to the point now where even Piers Morgan is starting to have to push back. And he wasn't doing this in the beginning when he started having these debates about Israel and Gaza on this show. But as time has gone by and the death toll continues to increase, now he's starting to say, OK, what the hell is happening here? Right. Still won't call it a genocide yet. Right. But it is what it is at this point in time. So Rabbi Shmuley came in hot, man. Like he came in like, attacking Norm Finkelstein as a person instead of attacking the issue. So I don't consider that a plus in reference to a debate.
Answer that point.
So let me answer your question directly. First of all, when you quote President Lula of Brazil, he is a criminal who served in jail for corruption. He has zero credibility. He also.
So apparently Lula is not credible. See what they try to do? Lula's not credible because he was in jail. Okay. So anyone who tells the truth about what Israel is doing, Zionists say you're not credible. And they'll do this a number of ways. They'll look at your record. They'll call you anti-Semitic. They'll tell you that you have mental issues or whatever. He kind of alluded to that as well with Norm. Anything to make people believe that Israel is in the right.
Who knows nothing about history. 10,000 Jews were gassed a day for 4 years after the Wannsee Conference in January 1942. To compare that to Gaza is an abomination. Secondly, Norman Finkelstein is a liar. The International Court of Justice specifically said that Israel is not committing a genocide. So when you tell me why...
They actually did not say those words. Here comes the exaggeration part. I watched the entire hearing. They didn't say Israel is not committing a genocide. They didn't say those words. They said, based on the evidence that was presented by South Africa and what they saw, they said it is plausible that they are committing a genocide. And they said that Israel has to do everything in its power that it can to not genocide the people in Gaza. And they also said that Israel has to report back to the court within a month with a report. So let's be clear here. The fact that Israel was actually on the world stage at the ICJ, that is a big deal. This is an embarrassment for Israel. Rabbi Shmuley's trying to downplay it. That's an embarrassment for Israel.
Why do I go after ad hominem? I'm questioning his academic credentials. He just lied on international TV. South Africa sued to get the ICJ to declare that Israel's committing a genocide, and they said they're not committing a genocide, and they said they would not stop the Israeli offensive. That is a straight out lie.
Okay, well, if you're going to call him a liar, amongst other things you've called him, I'm going to go back to Norman Finkelstein and get him to respond to that.
Would you like me to respond now?
Yes, please. Yeah, I think it's only reasonable you should. Yeah.
Well, I'm not sure what was the purpose to inviting either me or Mr. Shmuley to this program, because obviously we are in two entirely different wavelengths. Mr. Shmuley is in the business, which is not surprising, of character assassination. He's in the business of libel. That's his job, because where he have to confront the facts, he would be in a very difficult situation.
So that part that Norm said there is very important. That is Rabbi Shmuley's job. His job is to lie and to assassinate your character, right? Because he does this with everyone, not just Norm, anyone who is criticizing Israel, Rabbi Shmuley does this to them as well. That's his job. That's why you see him out in the front in the spotlight like that. He's supposed to try to demonize your character, and he's supposed to lie as much as possible. That's why you see him everywhere. That's why you see him on this show multiple times. I don't know why Piers keeps bringing him back on the show, but that's why you see him the most. And two, when you're actually having a debate, I was in the debate team when I was in high school. When you're having a debate, one of the rules of debate is that you cannot make personal attacks. You can only debate the issue at hand. So when Rabbi Shmuley comes in and starts making personal attacks towards Norm Finkelstein, I would say you actually already lost the debate, if I'm going by the rules.
So let me make one clarification. None of my remarks bear on my personal opinions. I simply am repeating what the documentary record shows. Now, according to Mr. Shmuley, I am a liar because, according to Mr. Shmuley, the International Court of Justice explicitly concluded that Israel was not committing a genocide. Now, I would say that Mr. Shmuley is suffering from what I would call a Judeo dementia, because there is no possibility on earth that any rational human being could have read the opinion or the ruling rendered by the International Court of Justice after the South Africa application and after the oral proceedings. There's no possibility on earth that any rational person can conclude that the International Court of Justice ruled that Israel was not committing a genocide.
Facts. Facts.
So we now have two difficulties. Number one, Mr. Shmuley seems to think his purpose to being on the program is to personally attack me, the Latin term ad hominem attacks. Number two, Rabbi Shmuley seems incapable of processing very basic facts. If Mr. Shmuley believes that the International Court of Justice ruled explicitly that Israel was not committing genocide, if that's what he truly believes, then I would say he's suffering from some form of Judeo dementia.
Okay.
It is funny, like during this debate, because I don't know if Norm maybe was a little tired or whatever, but the look that Norm had on his face from the very beginning of this debate was just kind of like, let's get this over with, you know, like, let's do this. Let's get this over with. Shmuley, you're a loudmouth. I got other things to do. That was the look he kind of had on his face.
Okay.
May I respond?
Yes, you may. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Pierce. You know, it's interesting, Pierce, that you and Norm are saying that I went ad hominem. No, I did not. I quoted his own words of Jewish antisemitism, vitriol, which are so extreme that they're
there goes that word again, anti-Semitism. Just throw it in anytime.
Shocking. I told you, he called his own parents haters of Germans. Not the Germans hated his parents and annihilated his family. His parents hated the Germans. But now he just now says, I suffer from Jewish dementia. Notice, it's not Shmuley who suffers dementia. It's always Jewish dementia. It's always Jews. Norman Finkelstein has now accused Israel of five different genocides. 1982, he accused Israel of genocide in Lebanon. It went on 2006, 2009, 2015. Now, this is the fifth. That means we Jews, I always thought Jews suck at sports and PR. We suck at genocide because we've attempted it five times. And yet in all the Arab-Israeli wars, Jews and Arabs together, the numbers that have died, including terrorists, are less than 100,000. Bashar al-Assad next door killed 600,000 in 2 years. We Jews ought to go to him and ask him, how do we finally do this? Because according to Norm, we've tried it for 30 years and we can't do it. In fact, since 1967, when Gaza came under Israeli control, the population of Gaza grew by 1 million people. How is that a genocide?
The population grew because you put more people there. The population grew because you kicked people out of the West Bank and you put them there. You know, notice everybody has the same talking points. All the Zionists have the same talking points. How did the population grow? If we're committing a genocide, how did the population grow? Easy, you put more people there. This is just common sense. Common sense.
Now, when Norm says that the ICJ said that Israel's committing a genocide, I repeat, Norm, respectfully, you are a fabricator. They said specifically that Israel has an obligation not to. South Africa asked for a cessation of hostilities. They refused. They repeated that refusal last week. How you could get on this program and actually fabricate? Well, I guess I know why, because even your mentors, Chicago professor Peter Nozick calls your scholarship, quote, trash. And this is trash because anyone can Google what we're saying.
Yeah, but Rabbi Shmuley, look, I'm going to jump in again because, again, what you're doing...
Notice again, he's attacking Norm and not the issue.
...thing is attacking your other debater here.
He said you're not, I suffer from dementia, for God's sake. Why don't you call him out on that? Dementia? Seriously?
With respect... With respect, what you're not doing is answering the specific questions. There are many, many people around the world increasingly concerned about the scale of Israel's response, the appalling death toll of children, the appalling number of children also being orphaned, the appalling number of women being killed, innocent women, and they don't see an end game. They just see Israel continuing to bomb, kill. But how does this end? If the next stage is Rafah, which now has six times as many people in it as it did 4 months ago and is a huge refugee camp, and you're trying to find just a few thousand Hamas amongst over 1.5 million people, then you're going to get even more people around the world saying,
And Rafah's right there on the border, you guys. Like, Rafah's like right there, and here's Egypt. So, again, they've been pushing them closer and closer to Egypt to try to get them to leave.
It is a senseless way of conducting war. Now, what do you say to
that? I hear you. Okay. In the lifetime of your parents, the greatest statesman of the 20th century, Winston Churchill, fought the greatest evil the world had ever seen. Now, the Americans used something called a Norden bomb site, and they only bombed during the day, and they lost so many crews as a result. It's a phenomenal new Apple series called Masters of the Air that shows this. The British came to the Americans and said, are you guys crazy? You're sending your pilots to die during the day? And the Americans said, well, we want to make sure we are not hitting civilians. We're hitting military sites with this great, it was the second greatest invention after the atomic bomb of the Second War, the Norden bomb site. That's not what you and the British did. You bombed at night indiscriminately, murdering millions of civilians. So
see, let's talk about him trying to, and now he's trying to deflect. So this conversation is about Israel and Gaza. Now he's trying to point his finger at Piers Morgan and say, well, let me tell you what the British did one time ago. Again, to make excuses for what Israel is doing. He's deflecting. Another part of the Zionist playbook. Lie as much as I can, and then if it still doesn't work, let me start deflecting and start blaming other people.
By the definition of Norman Finkelstein, who says that whether you intentionally target civilians, which Israel does not, Israel loses hundreds of soldiers.
But the whole point, strikes. Rabbi Shmuley.
Wait, no, but I'm asking, but I need to put one question to Norman Finkelstein.
Let me respond to your argument.
Was Britain a terrorist state fighting the Nazis?
Okay,
yes or no?
Hostile man, coming in hostile.
Indiscriminately.
Yes,
to hear his response.
Let me ask Norman that. What I would say to that, for what it's worth, is that there was huge regret over things like the carpet bombing of Dresden, which led directly,
Then when you start to prove that you know they're lying, or you start to tell the truth, then what they'll try to do is they'll interrupt you. That's why, notice they do this every time. Notice the Zionists do this every time. Once you start proving them wrong, then they're going to try to interrupt you.
It was April 1945. Let's go to Cologne, let's go to Dresden, let's go to Hamburg.
Let me finish. Yes. Which led directly to the Geneva Convention to try and prevent these things happening again. Many people think what's happening now in Gaza is a form of that happening again. Norman Finkelstein.
No. What's happening in Gaza is what the Americans did with a Norden bomb site. The Israelis are using surgical target.
Okay. Now he's blaming the Americans. So he went from blaming the British for previous war, and now he's blaming the Americans. Now he's saying they're using surgical spots. They're very precise with who they target. Gaza is destroyed. when you are hitting refugee camps and you're killing all these damn kids, you're not being surgical. You're not being precise. And he knows that. This guy is a liar. This guy is a con man. People need to stop talking to him. I would advise Piers Morgan, stop bringing this guy on your show. I really would say this. Kudos to Norm for sitting through this and tolerating this. But after this, stop bringing him on your show. And I would honestly say to other commentators as well, stop bringing him on your show as well. RFK Jr., you need to get as far away from this guy as possible. The more you guys continue to bring him on the show, the more damage this guy does.
It strikes.
Well, they're killing a lot of children.
Hamas lives under their homes.
Rabbi Shmuley, with respect, if Israel's being that precise, why is it killing so many children?
Firstly, I want to know what is the accuracy of your numbers, because I trust Hamas as much as I trust. They're complete liars. Secondly.
Oh, here comes this part. Now the numbers are incorrect. But Israel's numbers are correct. Every story that Israel is told, that Netanyahu is told, that the IDF is told, we're just supposed to take it with a grain of salt. We're supposed to believe everything that they say. They're telling the truth. They're honest. But anytime something, information comes from Gaza or the West Bank, we're not supposed to trust it. The numbers are wrong. Now he's saying, oh, it's the numbers. Everybody that's calling you out and sitting here lying on you, everybody's wrong. The entire world, the international community has risen up against you. Everyone sees what's happening. And everybody's wrong? Get out of here, man.
Hamas, unfortunately, wants these children to die, because the more that die, the more you're going to challenge me on TV. Israel wants them to live. Israel withdrew in 2005. Hamas builds their military installations under these children's homes, under their.
If you know that they're under the homes and they're under the hospitals, as you have claimed, why isn't the IDF going under the homes and under the hospitals into the tunnels to just target Hamas? You know, they continue to tell on themselves.
Kindergartens, under their nurseries, under their hospitals.
All right,
we now found 350 miles of tunnels under children's homes. That's the size of the New York subway system.
I want to be fair to both sides on time. Norma Finkelstein, your response.
What would you like me to respond to?
I suppose the analogy with World War II and the fact that indisputably, you know, many hundreds of thousands, if not millions of civilians died in that conflict. And the argument is it was for the greater good of defeating the Nazis. Do you see any parallel with wanting, and I completely understand Israel's desire, fervent desire, to eliminate Hamas after what they did on October the 7th, particularly as Hamas has stated again and again, they want to keep repeating it again and again. So on that particular argument about when you wage a war against whether it's the Nazis or Hamas, a lot of civilians tragically will get killed in the process, but ultimately that shouldn't stop you going ahead with the war to try and achieve your goal. What do you say to that?
Let me chime in here for just a second and then pass it to Norm. There's another talking point that I'm starting to notice, and Pierce just did it. Israel wants to, you know, root out Hamas. And he says that you can't blame them for wanting to do that after what happened on October 7th. But let's flip it around. You would never be allowed to come onto national television and to say, well, Hamas wants to root out the Israeli government, wants to root out the IDF because of what they've been doing to the Palestinian people since 1948. It's never the other way around. You see the problem? They continue to show you that one group of people is favorable over the other. They continue to show you that one group matters more than the other.
What I would say to that is there's a very good reason why this case was brought before the International Court of Justice. That is, as I'm sure you know, that if you examine what Israel has done in Gaza since October 7th, by virtually every dimension you examine it, the intensity of the bombing, the density of the bombing, the magnitude of destruction of civilian dwellings, civilian infrastructure, the percentage, the absolute number of children killed, the relative number of children killed to combatants killed, the percentage of women and children versus men killed, the number of medical personnel killed, the number of journalists killed, the number of UN workers killed. By virtually every dimension that you examine the conflict, by virtually any and every metric that you examine the conflict, Israel's assault on Gaza, which we should bear in mind, is among the most densely populated places on God's earth.
Yep.
And it has been sealed off.
Pause here for a second. You see, this is why it's always important to remember who has the power and who does not. And Israel has the power. And the way that Rabbi Shmuley talks about this, he makes it sound like Hamas is incredibly more powerful than the IDF, right? So the IDF, they have superior weapons. They have more weapons than what Hamas has. Hamas doesn't have that type of weapon capability, right? So they have better weapon capability. Honestly, there's really no comparison with this. It's not even fair to compare the two, to be honest. Israel also has the Iron Dome, which is supposed to be there to protect them, right? So Israel has an army. Gaza does not. They have Hamas, but Hamas is not an army. Those are people who rose up and basically created their own sense of community to push back against what Israel was doing to the Palestinian people. So the thing to always come back to is who actually has the power. And this is something that Rabbi Shmuley does not want to admit. And for the people who try to say, and he'll try to say this too, for the people who try to say, no, there's no ethnic cleansing, there's no genocide. Okay. Why did Israel sterilize Ethiopian Jewish women against their will? Why'd they do that? Why did they do it against their will? Why did they lie to those women and make them think it was some other type of jab that they were getting and not tell them the truth that they were actually sterilizing those women against their will? And why would they sterilize them? Because they don't want them to reproduce. Let's continue.
From humanity since 2006. As Giora Island put it in March 2004, Giora Island was the head of the Israeli National Security Council. He described Gaza, and I'm quoting him now, as a huge concentration camp. That's not me. That's Giora Island, the former head of the Israeli National Security Council. So, if you put all of these metrics together and you put in and you add in the context being a concentration camp in which half the people are children, 70% are refugees.
Yep.
If you add in the context and the metrics, there is a very good reason why Israel was brought before the International Court of Justice. Now, Mr. Shmuley has every right to question the authority of the numbers, the figures, and so forth. I am a strong believer in the right of Holocaust deniers to make a case before the public, because as John Stuart Mill once put it, we are all fallible, and being fallible, we have to always have a place in our minds open to the possibility that we are wrong. So, like Holocaust deniers, I do believe that Rabbi Mr. Shmuley should have the right to speak. However, granting that right, he has a very tall order. If a Holocaust denier wants to deny the Nazi Holocaust, he or she has to refute a vast corpus of scholarship attesting to the reality of the Nazi Holocaust. In the same way, Rabbi Shmuley, if he wants to deny that a plausible case for genocide can be made in Gaza, he has to refute a vast body of documentation. And that documentation ran as it was presented by the South African application. It ran to 84 single-spaced pages with literally hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of footnotes. Now, that's the first hurdle.
Are we really going to allow
me? Allow me to finish.
Come on. No.
Allow me to finish.
Your debating style is to drone on. Coma-inducing, that's how you debate. You try to put your opponents into slumber. For God's sake, you made your point. It's time for me to respond. That's a dialogue.
No,
I'm not dominating this debate. Like you did with Alan Dershowitz, and you dominated. You took three quarters of the time. I won't allow it. Now, let me respond. First of all, Pierce.
Now, this is where Pierce, being the moderator, should actually come in and moderate, right? You don't allow the people that are debating to just kind of run the show. That's why you have a moderator. So you should come in and actually moderate.
I'm glad that Norm has at least had the intellectual honesty to concede the first point, that the ICJ, the International, never ruled against Israel. Now notice he's saying that South Africa brought the case. They lost the case, first point, because I've been attacking his credibility. For you to say, Pierce, I'm attacking him ad hominem, his personality, I'm not. The question is whether this man is a scholar or not. He has no tenure. He was denied tenure at DePaul University. He is only known because he's a Jewish anti-Semite. Now
Rabbi Shmuley is showing his elitism. Who cares if Norm Finkelstein has tenure? A lot of faculty, in fact, most faculty members do not have tenure. I worked in higher ed for a long time. I know this. The way that you get tenure is based on your research. Now, I think it should be based on your research and your teaching. I've met faculty members that are excellent teachers, but they didn't have the time actually to put in enough research, so they don't qualify for tenure because of that reason. I think it should be both, but they usually focus more so on the research. That being said, who gives a fuck? Who cares if he doesn't have tenure? So you don't consider someone to be credible or knowledgeable enough if they don't have tenure. So now everything that Norm Finkelstein has researched, everything he's written, is just thrown out the window because he doesn't have tenure. But you see, you know what though? What's really interesting is because Rabbi Shmuley doesn't say that to other people who don't have tenure, and he considered them to be credible, especially as long as they're giving him any type of attention or publicity. He didn't think that about Oprah. He didn't go up to Oprah and say, "You're not educated enough. You don't have tenure." He didn't say that to Michael Jackson. Now, all of a sudden, Norm's research should be thrown out because he doesn't have tenure. When I tell you that academia is incredibly bougie, that they can be incredibly pompous, and also sometimes just straight up assholes, believe me.
Number two, this is the fifth time he accused Israel of genocide. He started in 1982 in Lebanon. Now, what does genocide mean? It was coined by a Holocaust survivor in 1947 named Raphael Lemkin. Geno is an ethnicity. Side means murder. It is the murder of an ethnicity. Norm needs to make the case that Israel is slaughtering Palestinians because they're Palestinians and Arabs and Muslims. Well, then how does Israel have 1.9 million totally safe Israeli citizens who vote in the Knesset, an Israeli Arab judge who put an Israeli, Israeli Arab judge who put an Israeli Jewish president in jail for rape, by the way? Why is
they always like to bring up the sexual assault in reference to the Palestinians being the perpetrator, even though the UN actually just released a statement that actually shows that there were Palestinian women that were sexually assaulted by IDF soldiers, and you don't hear them bring that up. Almost everything that you hear people like Rabbi Shmuley say that Hamas and the Palestinian people are doing, it's usually the IDF is doing those things. Here he goes with the sexual again. By the way, this guy sold dildos, okay? There's that too. I don't know what it is with him and the sex and the genitals. Just saying.
Is that, none of the Israeli Arabs have risen up to stop this genocide because it has nothing to do with
all right, but let me ask you this. Let me ask you this.
It has to do with a date called October 7th.
Let me ask you this.
1,200 Jews were shot in the genitals, burned to death, slaughtered, and no democracy should allow that. Except
listen to this again. Notice how he brings up the genitals again. This guy's obsessed with people's genitals, okay? He's doing that on purpose, though, to make the people more angry, to pull more rage out of people, right? That's why he's doing that. He's going for the emotional here, but it's not working. How many times are you going to say genitals?
For one person, Norm Finkelstein.
No, no.
Because he has an irrational hatred of Jews.
Rabbi Shmuley, with respect, Norman Finkelstein is not the only person seriously concerned about what's happening in terms of Israel's response.
Genocide? Using the word genocide?
I would say the majority of the world right now is concerned about what's going on in Gaza.
Is President Biden and the United
States? And believes that Israel... No.
See what he's doing? Look, let me tell you about the bubble. Either he's living in a bubble or he's lying on purpose. How can you not know that the majority of the world is against what Israel is doing? Think about that. So what does he do? Is the president of the United States? He knows the president of the United States belongs to AIPAC. He knows the president of the United States belongs to the Israeli lobby. He's not stupid. So he's going to try to use that one person in that one position to prove that most people don't think that way. I've met some characters, okay? But I have never seen someone as slimy and just as creepy as this guy. How do you get to be this dirty? How do you get to be this cruddy, you know, just slimy con man? How do you get to be this way?
Response is now becoming wholly disproportionate. And again, I ask you this question. Netanyahu, incredibly unpopular back home in Israel, you know, probably wouldn't even be prime minister now if it hadn't been for this war, given the scale of the social unrest and protests over his attempt to thwart the power of the Supreme Court. So you've got a deeply unpopular prime minister, particularly with Israelis' own people, right, waging a war, and many people cynically think he's just going to keep doing this because it buys him more time. But if I could ask him, and I can't because he won't come on again on this program to date, I would simply say, when does this end? How many people are you prepared to kill on the other side before you declare mission accomplished? And why would you think, by the way, that killing so many innocent people in Gaza and destroying so much of the homes in Gaza, north and south, why would you think that that would end radicalization of people who may be sympathetic to Hamas? Why would it not have the opposite effect?
When I saw you face to face in your studio in London a few months ago, I told you I think that you've been fair on this conflict. So I respect your question and I want to take it seriously. First of all, Netanyahu's unpopularity means nothing. Churchill destroyed the Nazis, saved Western civilization, and immediately was kicked out by the British. He actually lost the election, as you well know. So that means nothing. It doesn't.
Churchill was also in power for a long time. Let's not pretend like Churchill was only there for like 4 years and then peaced out. So I don't know if that's like the best example. He was also getting older. He also had health issues. Make sure you add that part. And then also, when he says that it doesn't matter if Netanyahu basically has a low, you know, approval rating, you know what he's really telling you, right? It does not matter, because the problem is not just Netanyahu. Netanyahu is a symptom of Zionism. The problem is Zionism. So Netanyahu can resign and someone else can win. But as long as Zionism is what is actually in charge and what is happening in Israel, nothing is going to change for the Palestinian people. It just, you know, this is very problematic.
I mean, Churchill wasn't a great man. It means nothing. Number two, let's say, for example, look where I am. I'm in the beauty of South Florida. This is where I grew up. Imagine that 6 million Jews living in Israel say, you know what? We've had it. We've tried this state 75 years. The whole world hates us. They want to kill us. We have people like Norman Finkelstein calling us satanic, saying that we come from a boil of hell. We have Norman Finkelstein saying that he cheered hallelujah when the women were shot in the genitals and raped. So we're going to move to...
There we go with the genitals and the sexual assault again. You guys see a pattern?
South Florida. They do a deal with Biden. Biden says, you know, it's cheaper for us to just move you guys to beautiful Florida than it is to give Israel. And Israel disappears, God forbid, in a very humanitarian way. No one dies. Now you're left with no Israel. Will that change for one moment, Pierce, all of the women in Gaza now under Hamas, the teenage girls who have tires put around their heads, who are burned to death by their brothers because they have sex before marriage? Will it change the fact that LGBTQ Palestinians have their genitals cut off and are castrated? Will it change?
Genitals again, and LGBTQ people can't get married in Israel, so I don't know what you're talking about. What he's showing you is he has a problem with the culture, period. He revealed this to you. He revealed himself. He has a problem with the culture that the Palestinian people have, period. And I think there's some exaggeration in there as well. You see that? He's showing you he don't like the culture. He's showing you he don't like the people right in your face.
The fact that any political protests on the part of Palestinians, no Israel anymore, against Hamas, have some shot 20 or 30 at a time by hooded terrorists. Will it change the fact that Palestinian Authority officials, their fellow are thrown off rooftops by Hamas, who did this in 2006 in a coup? Will it change the fact that there isn't one Arab democracy? Will it change the fact that in Syria, 600,000 Arabs, 600,000, Norm Finkelstein doesn't give a damn about them, were killed between 2011 and 2014?
Syria is probably not a good example to bring up, considering the fact that the U.S. government is occupying a third of Syria, which is the part that has the oil. And also considering the fact that Israel is also bombing Syria right now, and also Lebanon. So Syria is probably not the best example to bring up. Not on this subject.
Israel is not the problem. Arab dictatorships, tyranny. Would it change the fact that Ismail Haniyeh is worth $4 billion? Would it change the fact that Khaled Mashal is worth $7 billion? It would change nothing. If Israel left the Middle East, the Arab world is still in crisis, killing teenagers, killing LGBTQ, destroying democracy, all dictatorship, kleptocracy. You have Mahmoud Abbas who's a...
Pause. You know he exposed himself, right? He said the Arab world. They don't want the Arab world to exist, period. They don't want it there. They don't want the people there. I told you the plan. The plan is to take over that entire region. Netanyahu made a statement recently. I'll see if I can find it on Twitter. Made a statement recently where he's talking about, and then we'll go on to liberate the people in Africa. I told you, they trying to go up in there too. How you gonna come into Africa and say you're gonna liberate the people there? How about you stay the fuck out of Africa, Netanyahu? How about you do that, okay? How about you fall all the way back and leave African people alone? Can you do that? 2024, you still got people trying to colonize up in Africa. How about you stay the fuck away from African countries? How about you do that?
billionaire. You have Yasser Arafat, who not only died on the Forbes 400 richest men in the world, which is shocking, but his wife still lives in a penthouse paid for by the Palestinians in Paris. And one final thing, when Norman Finkelstein fabricates and says about the terrible plight of the Palestinians in Gaza, they were given about $100 billion over the past 18 years. That is triple per capita what the Marshall Plan was given to Europeans. Look what they did with it, Germany, France, you know, England.
How much money have we given you, though? Okay, you get what, $3.8 billion from the United States every year? The money that's been given to the Palestinian people is, it's minuscule when you're seriously comparing it to how much money has been given to Israel. What are we doing here? This is what I said before. Why are we giving the money? Why are we giving them money? Everybody bring this up. Bring this up to your politicians. Bring this up to the representatives. Bring this up to people in your community and start pushing back and say, why the hell are we giving them billions of dollars every year instead of giving it to people in this country? Everybody say this with me, especially those of you upset about universal healthcare, not having healthcare in this country. Bring this issue up to your representatives. You're upset because we don't have reparations for descendants of slaves in this country. Bring this issue up to your representatives. Your reparations is going to Israel. Your healthcare is going to Ukraine. Everybody should be livid about this. I don't understand. Even if you don't agree with these universal policies, why the hell is our money going over there? In Israel, they got universal healthcare. In Israel, they can go to college for free. You can't even do that in this country. Everybody should be pushing back on this. I can't. Stop voting for these politicians that are bought and owned by AIPAC and the Israeli lobby. All this shit need to go. Period. It's that simple.
And you know what the Palestinians did with it? With what, Hamas? They built tunnels with giant television screens where the Hamas Hitler, Yichya Ayash, is living now with his family.
So the IDF and other Israeli officials actually admitted on CNN that Israel built those tunnels under Al-Shifa Hospital. So this is, once again, this guy is exaggerating, and he's going to pretend like Israel didn't build some of those tunnels. Like, I can't.
They built one bomb shelter.
Let me go to Norman Finkelstein. Norman, the question I would have for you is this. Do you accept that Hamas need to be removed from power in Gaza?
I would say that the preeminent, excuse me, I would say that the preeminent question at the present moment ought to be, do I accept the fact that the Israeli government ought to be removed from power?
Well, hang on, that's a different question. No, with respect, that's a different question. I can ask you that separately. I can ask you that separately, but the specific question I have for you, particularly given what you said after October the 7th, is simply, should Hamas remain in power?
Should Hamas remain in power? I think that the Palestinian people should be able to determine their own future and determine their leadership. That's just the basic democratic
principle. What is your personal opinion?
Now, I don't decide what people should do with their lives.
You've expressed many strong opinions about it. Hang on.
When was the last election?
I can do an interview, thank you. The problem I have with that response is you're very quick to level the charge of genocide at Israel. And many people would agree with you, many wouldn't. But you're not so keen to be held to account for your view about Hamas. And I don't see how anyone, after what they did on October the 7th, could possibly conclude they should stay in power.
Pierce, I don't want to have to redo the interviews you did with me. I was very clear about my opinion when you asked about October 7th. I was also very clear as to what I believe Hamas should or shouldn't do regarding its leadership or its current power in Gaza. I've not tried to evade any of your questions.
Okay, well, just okay for those for those who may not have seen our previous conversations, I simply ask again.
That's fine.
It is a simple question.
Okay,
should Hamas stay in power? Because Israel's whole argument is that they have to keep going with this warfare to eradicate Hamas. And my question for you is, do you think that in principle Hamas should stay in power?
But Hamas didn't exist in 1948 during the Nakba. You see, this is why this argument doesn't hold weight.
Well, Pierce, I'm going to answer you because I never fear the truth, and I'm not going to try to evade your question. Let's take a simple metric. We'll take the question of children killed.
Oh my God,
October
answer the 7th. Question. Should Hamas stay in power?
No, these
sir.
Are different.
Answer
these are answers question. To different questions. Okay.
Just answer the question, Norm, for God's sake. You said you don't want to evade the truth. Should Hamas stay in power or not? Answer the question.
You know what, Norm? Next time, if you need a wing woman or whatever, because if I was on this show, I'll tell you right now, this is why they wouldn't have me on there. If I was on this show, it would have been some things. It would have been some things. Because I honestly would have told Rabbi Shmuley, I would have honestly said, can you just shut the hell up? How about you do that? How about you do that one? How about for once you just shut up? Him and Michael Rappaport, all the time I see it, just for once, just shut up.
Pierce, either you're going to moderate the program or there's honestly no point in continuing.
I do think it's I do think it's a very simple question, and it goes right to the heart.
No, it's not.
It goes right to the heart of Israel's argument about why they are continuing to execute the war.
Pierce, how about letting me decide whether it's a simple question? How about letting me decide?
Well, either Hamas stays in power or it doesn't, doesn't it?
Okay.
I don't think you have to be a professor to answer the question.
Pierce, there's a difference between whether or not Hamas stays in power and whether Hamas should be in power. So let me get into the stays in power is a military question. Should be in power, well, let's look at it. I say if Hamas, which is responsible for the killings of 36 children on October 7th, should not stay in power, then you must certainly agree, Piers, and I'm going to kindly ask you to please answer me. You must surely agree then that Israel, which has killed now approximately 12,000 children and is plausibly accused of having killed them in the course of a genocide. Now, I'm going to ask you, Piers, to
please answer
the question.
What is your source for 12,000 children? What's the source? What is your source, please? Okay. What's your source?
Well, Piers, it's the Palestinian Health Authority run by Hamas. We know that.
Run by Hamas. Wait, no.
So here we go again. When it comes to the numbers, what is your source? Oh, the source is in Israel, so it's not true. Let's be clear. You guys didn't get your freaking numbers right the first time. The first time this event happened, you said it was over 1,400 people that were killed. Then you come back and you say 1,200 because the IDF actually killed some of their own people. Not to mention the IDF killed three of their own freaking hostages. Hamas actually offered a ceasefire just a couple days ago, and Netanyahu rejected it. They offered a ceasefire for you to get the hostages back in exchange for a ceasefire, and Netanyahu rejected it. It was never about those damn hostages. And I continue to say that this was their opportunity to get rid of all the freaking people. And meanwhile, while they're killing women and children in Gaza, they're still taking people out of their homes in the West Bank. This is a very dangerous thing that is happening in Israel, and this has been going on way before October 7th, and I've said it before and I'll say it again. If Israel is not stopped They will continue to do this to other countries as well. You think this ends with Gaza? You think this ends with the West Bank? They will do it to Lebanon. They will do it to Syria. They're bombing deep in the heart of Lebanon now, not just on the border anymore. They will do this to Jordan if they wanted to. They're talking about going into Africa. This will spread. This is a problem. Big problem. Big one.
No, Rabbi Shmuley, you don't interrupt. This is actually an important question and an important moment in the debate. Continue, Norman Finkelstein.
So I have to ask you, Piers, if you believe that Hamas should not stay in power because it killed 36 children on October 7th, then you must surely agree thousand times more emphatically that the Israeli government should not be in power because it killed 12,000 children, not as collateral damage, but plausibly, according to 15 of the 17 judges on the highest judicial body
okay,
in
yeah,
the world.
Okay, you said that point. Okay, here's my answer. Here's my answer. You haven't so far answered my question. If you do, I will give you an emphatic answer to yours. So let me just ask again, should Hamas...
So this has gone on pretty long, and I do have two other stories, so sorry about that, guys. But you can see the rest of the debate on Piers Morgan Uncensored. And I do want to do a poll for you guys. And I want to ask you who you thought won that debate. Because honestly, let me show you this first. Because I'm going to show you the propaganda. Because it's a nightmare, right? So here's the propaganda. Look at this. Here's what they leave out. Here's what Rabbi Shmuley's leaving out. Credible allegations of sexual assault on Palestinian women. You see this? This is a UN report. Credible allegations of sexual assault on Palestinian women. In a statement, the UN Rights Office says there are credible allegations of arbitrary detention, executions and sexual assaults of Palestinian women and children in the Gaza Strip, calling for an urgent and independent investigation. But you won't hear Rabbi Shmuley mention that. All these things that they continue to say that Hamas is doing, that's what Israel is doing. And there's credible evidence in reference to the Palestinian women and children. They still don't have credible evidence in reference to these claimed attacks on October 7th about sexual assault. Now we're going to do a poll. I'm going to poll you right now. Let me jump in. We're going to do a poll because I want to know who you thought won the debate. Okay, I'll take the poll. I don't know why more people didn't vote. But anyway, I said, who won the debate, Norm or Shmuley? 86% said Norm, 2% said Shmuley, and 12% said I don't know. And I always have mad respects for the I don't knows because those individuals are keeping it real with me and not pretending like they do know when they don't know.